Okay, Revelations chapter 20, verses 11 through 15. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were open. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. Okay, let's quickly review what we talked about last time. We talked about the millennial kingdom, and you recall we wanted to try to have a fuller description of that, so I spent some time sharing with you the ideas of what's going to actually happen during the millennial kingdom. We talked about the changes to the physical environment. For example, it appears that all the land masses on planet Earth are going to be come together to be one. There'll be no mountains. There'll be no necessarily big rivers. Why? So that everybody will have access to Jerusalem, where Jesus Christ is going to be reigning on his throne. We talked about the changes to animals, right? The lion will lie down with the lamb, and the child will put their hand in the viper's nest, and they won't be bitten. You know, this whole idea of animals becoming more docile. We talked about the longevity of human beings living longer, like perhaps some of the time frame that we see in the Old Testament, several hundred years. The changes to society that are going to take place. The renewal of all things that Jesus talked about. Again, Jesus is reigning in the temple in Jerusalem. Resurrected, glorified Christians that return with Christ are going to be ruling with him in some fashion. There's a lot of discussion about how that's actually going to take place. But it will be a wonderful time to live, an almost perfect environment. I say almost perfect because original sin will not be wiped out, even in the millennial kingdom. And so the people that repopulate the earth, many of them are not going to be Christians. They're going to reject Jesus as their Lord and Savior. We talked about that last week. Why would anybody do that? Well, that's because they love their sin more than they love Jesus Christ, more than they love eternal life. And we concluded that only the power of God through the Holy Spirit can create a Christian. We talked also last week about Satan being released from the abyss after the 1,000 years is up. Why would God want to do that? Well, very simply, so that Satan can gather all of the unbelievers who live during that millennial period so that they can realize their final judgment. And remember Gog and Magog, we talked briefly about that. That just is our terms representing all of the unbelievers during that time. And then we concluded by talking about the final destiny of Satan. We found out last week is the lake of fire, hell, and he is in there for eternity, okay? All right, now, as we get to this last part of chapter 20, before the inauguration of heaven, let me just say that, you know, since the fall of man in the Garden of Eden, for all those thousands of years, for all those billions and billions of sins that have taken place, Satan, the great deceiver, the great liar, has tried to convince man of one thing. And this is your first question. What has Satan tried to convince man of since the beginning? And that is that there would be no final judgment, that there would be no final accountability, that there would be no final punishment. Well, here we have it now. And when you think about atheism or evolution, any of those theories which say that the Lord God Almighty does not exist, if you think about all of the false religions of the world that deny the Godhead, they deny the deity of Jesus Christ. They deny the reality of God the Holy Spirit. Where are they now at the end of chapter 20? Where's Buddha? Where's Muhammad? Where's Allah? Where's Krishna? Where's Confucius? Where's Joseph Smith? Where is all of these people? They're dead. And they're dead wrong, or they never even existed at all. And they're all part of the great satanic deception, your question number two. They're all part of the great satanic deception. Anything or anyone that denies the deity of Jesus Christ, denies that the only way to have eternal life is by accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior, is a satanic deception. Let's be clear about that. Well, where's Satan now? Well, he's been thrown into the lake of fire. He's gone forever. Who stands now alone to face final judgment? Your question number three. Unbelievers, they stand alone. Those people who decided to believe the lies of Satan over the truth of Almighty God. And guess what? They have no advocate. They must face the judge alone. And that's what we're going to consider this morning. So this is pretty scary stuff, if you ask me. Look at verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne. You're probably tired of me saying this. And then I saw, that's the little phrase. We're getting into another vision that John is having. The great white throne. By the way, 50 times in the book of Revelation, thrones are discussed. If you recall, way back in chapter 1, verse 4, the book opened with a throne. That was the throne of God, the throne of majesty, the throne where God the Father was sitting. And now it's closing with another throne, only this is a different type of throne. Your question number four, this is a throne of judgment. This is a throne of judgment. Now, it seems to be somewhere in an uncreated universe, if you will. I say that because verse 11 says, the earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. So we have this throne and this judgment that is going to take place. If you say where, what part of the world is it going to take place? And it's not taking place any part of this world, okay? It's just taking place somewhere that God is going to have for this special judgment. Now, it's called a great white throne. Your question five, why is it a great throne? Well, first of all, it's a great throne, not because of its size, but because of its significance. That's why it's called a great throne, because of its authority, its power, its comprehensiveness, its finality. This is the last judgment here. Why is it called white? It's called white because that reflects the purity, the holiness, and the righteousness of the throne. It is the judgment throne of Almighty God. By the way, have any of you ever been involved in court proceedings? Ever been called to jury duty, or perhaps you work there, or maybe you've been a witness or something like that? It's pretty scary stuff, isn't it? I mean, it's pretty official. It's not the kind of thing that you want to fool around in. Just try to imagine how these people are going to feel, what they're going to be experiencing when they are involved in this, and this is regarding their final destiny, their eternal destiny. And then John says, then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. So now we have to ask the question, your question number seven, who is seated on the throne of judgment? Well, it might seem that, well, it's going to be God the Father, okay? But then listen to some of these passages we read in the New Testament. Acts chapter 10, 42 says this, he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead, referring to Jesus Christ. Acts chapter 17, verses 30 and 31. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead, talking about Jesus Christ. 2 Timothy chapter 4. In the presence of God and of Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead. In John chapter 5, it says, moreover, the Father judges no one, but he has entrusted all judgment to the Son. When we read passages like that, we begin to realize Jesus Christ is the one who is sitting on that judgment throne. Jesus Christ is the one who is going to be judging these people. Now, why is Jesus on the throne? Well, there's a couple of reasons. First of all, the reason why Jesus Christ is on the throne and not God the Father is that Jesus Christ has earned the right to judge those people. He's the one that has died for our sins. He's the one that took the punishment for our sins. He's the one that has fulfilled all of the just requirements of the Old Testament law. So, of course, it's only right that he should judge us. Jesus Christ. The second reason is Jesus Christ has fulfilled God's only plan of salvation. He died for our sins. He took God's punishment. He fulfilled all of the just requirements of the Old Testament law. The third one is he's in the best position to judge us. You know why? Because he was a human being just like us. Listen, Jesus Christ is not some cold, far-off, uninterested deity. He is somebody who wants to intimately be involved in our lives. He is one of us. Now, just think about this, folks. Think about the position that unbelievers have put themselves in, okay? Your question number 9. Think about the position unbelievers have put themselves in. Not only have they rejected their only Savior, Jesus Christ, not only have they rejected their only advocate, Jesus Christ, but they've rejected the very one who is now going to judge them. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. What's the significance of this? Well, the significance of this, your question number 9, is very simple. It means everything. The totality, all of creation, all of reality. See, here's the point, okay? All of creation, all of reality has been tainted by sin. We are on the verge of heaven. We are on the verge of complete and final redemption, the creation of a new heaven and a new earth. There's anything related to sin in any way has to be destroyed, has to be gone forever. That's how complete the new heavens and the earth will be. By the way, there will not even be a remembrance of sin, I don't think, when we're in heaven. We're not even going to remember it. We're not even going to remember it. That's how complete it's going to be. Well, then we have the final judgment. Look at verse 12. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne. Okay, now, let's make sure we understand this. Who is going to be judged here in this final judgment? Only unbelievers. Only unbelievers are going to be judged here. Believers pass over this judgment. Why? Because Jesus Christ has taken this punishment for our sins. That's why. Okay? Our faith in Jesus Christ exempts us from this judgment. So this final judgment in chapter 20 is only for unbelievers. Believers pass over this judgment. When it says great and small, that just refers to everybody. Everybody who has not accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. No believer is going to, unbeliever is going to be exempt from this judgment. Okay? They're not going to be exempt because they have no faith in Jesus Christ. No wealthy unbeliever is going to be able to pay their way out of this judgment. No influential unbeliever is going to be able to finagle their way out of this. This is it, okay? Everyone who has rejected Jesus as their Lord and Savior is going to face this judgment absolutely alone. Now look at verse 12. It says, and the books were opened. What books are these? Your question 12. These are the books that record everything that they have done. Everything that they have ever said. Everything that they have ever thought. Can you just imagine that? If everything you ever said, did, and thought was written down somewhere, and then you had to give an account of it before the Lord? Remember what Jesus says in Matthew 12? A good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. But I tell you that everyone will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every empty word that they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. Now look, we all know that the wheels of justice sometimes turn very slowly. I understand that, but you know what? They still turn, and eventually there is that final judgment. And that's what we have right here. Look at verse 12. Another book was opened. This is the book of life. Six times in the book of Revelation, the book of life is mentioned. Whose names are written in the book of life? Only believers. Only people who have accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Only people who have understood that they are sinful, that our sins separate us from God, that there's no way we can pay for our sins. I mean, if we pay for our sins, what's the wage of sin? Death. We're going to be separated from God, so that's not going to work, okay? But they understand that on the cross, God punishes Jesus in our place. Look at verse 12. The dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. Now, before we get to this, let's just think about this. Notice they're judged. Unbelievers are judged according to what they had done. So just so there's no confusion, all right, let's make sure we understand this. What has God already told us about how we will be judged if we don't accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior? In other words, I can imagine an unbeliever standing before God saying, hey, you know, God, you can write down anything you want in your great books. You can write down everything I said, everything I've done, everything I've thought, but you never told me what I was going to be judged by. You never told me the standard. Really? How about this? Matthew 5:48. Be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. How about back in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 6, 4 through 6. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Jesus repeats that, by the way, in Matthew chapter 22. There is not a human being who has ever lived outside of Jesus Christ who can keep that commandment for 5 minutes, let alone a whole life. And if you think you can, you don't fully understand what that means. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength. Really? With all your mind and heart and strength and soul? You can't do that for 5 minutes. How about the Ten Commandments? Well, we could go on, but I won't go on. But several things are clear. Here's the first thing that is clear. Your question 14. What's God's standard of judgment? It's perfection. It's perfection. And you know, if you stand there and you complain or you meet somebody who goes, well, that's not fair. Really? Wait a minute. We're talking about heaven. You know, we're talking about eternal life. Do you think a passing grade is going to be a 60 to get into heaven? No, it's 100, period. It's 100, okay? Number two, God has made his standard clear. God has made his standard clear. Let me read Paul chapter 1 in Romans. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness, since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that all people are without excuse. No one's going to be able to stand before God at this great white judgment and say, gee, you know, I would have believed in you, but I just didn't know. That's not an option. That's not going to work. Third point here, who is going to be able to meet the standard? Your question number 16. Nobody. Nobody's going to be able to meet the standard. What does Paul say in Romans 3:23? For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And then finally, number four, who will be saved from this judgment? Nobody. Nobody. Not one single person is going to be saved from the great white judgment. Everybody is going to be condemned. How sad is that? How sad is that? Verse 13, the sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. This is just a reference to the totality of this final judgment. All the unbelievers, regardless of how you died, this is when you're going to be judged, right here. And then it says each person was judged according to what they had done. Notice this is the second time that these passages refer to people being judged based upon what they had done. Why is it repetitive? Because it's for emphasis. It's for emphasis. This is one of the reasons how you know we're not talking about believers. Believers are not judged according to what they had done. Well, how are believers judged? We're judged according to our faith in Jesus Christ, and we pass over this judgment. So that's how you know that this is not talking about believers. This is only talking about unbelievers. And then it says here, then death and Hades were thrown into the fire, the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. Well, here we finally get some good news. I take it that this is good news, that the destruction of death and Hades. Why are they being destroyed? Because there's no death or Hades when we get to heaven. And heaven begins in chapter 21. So, in the end, even these two things are going to be destroyed, okay? So what happens, number 18, what happens to death and Hades? They're destroyed. And then finally, what is the second death? The second death is the lake of fire. The second death is the lake of fire. And then again, just to be repetitive, verse 15 says, anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. This is just another way of saying the only way to be saved, the only way to have eternal life, the only way to make it to heaven is by accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Jesus is the only way, period. And I hope that this inspires us, again, to be involved in evangelism. Why should we be involved in evangelism? Folks, this is the ultimate destiny for unbelievers. We know that. We know that. It's clearly written. We have the cure for what ails humanity. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is why I keep telling you, every one of you should be ready to share your testimony with anyone at the drop of a hat. That simply means, why have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Can you imagine meeting somebody that believes something else and you say to them, well, how come you believe that? And they go, well, I don't know. You know, or they don't have an explanation for you, okay? If you've never done this before, take the time, write out your testimony on a piece of paper. I'm serious. We've taught evangelism classes here before where we have the participants do that. Just write it out, okay? Write it out, fine-tune it. Get it to a paragraph or two. Memorize it so that it'll just flow off your lips so naturally. This is when I accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. This is why I believe Jesus is my Lord and Savior. You should be able to talk about this very easily to people. And as I said before, okay, we're coming up to the holiday season. I know it's a secular world, Thanksgiving, you know, people think about shopping, Christmas, you know, the presents and Santa Claus. Okay, you understand that. But it also provides us a wonderful opportunity to be able to invite people to church, a wonderful opportunity to be able to say to them, well, I know that, you know, you really like Christmas because you're going to get presents, but, you know, here's the real reason we celebrate Christmas. Boom, you go right into the gospel of Jesus Christ. So anyway, I hope you're ready for heaven, because that's what we're going to talk about next week. Amen.